This is the tale of a secret and ancient past. This is the story of a belief system that has been lost in the mists of time and can now be revealed once again. I have journeyed on a quest to uncover the secrets of the ancient serpent cults that Victorian historians clouded in mystery and hid away from the world. There truly is a whole new world opening up before our eyes, and suddenly, and often without warning, we will be faced with a reinterpretation of history that we are simply not looking for. This is the story of that search and a revelation of the discovery that is the secret of the serpent. We will begin our story at Avebury in England, a massive centre of ancient serpent worship. Avebury is a huge British temple and stone monument erected around 2000 BC in the shape of a serpent when seen from the sky. Once known as Avebury, which is named Abiri after the serpent worshippers. Abir, incidentally, means the solar snake or fire snake, and this is important because the serpent fire will be spoken of for thousands of years as a force and aid to true enlightenment. Of course, even as Avebury, the Ave reverts back to the root of Eve, which means female serpent. The pathway of Avebury passes through a large circular temple of the sun, emerging and then winding again and ending with an oddly, not quite circular head, directly in line with Snake's Head Hill, or Hackpen. This central circle is symbolic of the sun, which is the male principle in the creative process. Once the serpent has passed through or around this circle, it is recharged for new life. These circular aspects of the stone circles of Europe are strangely reminiscent of the temples of Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent in Mexico, which were circular and were entered by a door like the mouth of a serpent. A very similar ritualistic influence to those based around Avebury and other stone circles. John Bathurst Dean explained in his book on serpent worship, a third description of temples consecrated to the service of the Ophites god remains to be considered. And these were not only the most rare, the most characteristic, and the most magnificent, but probably the most sacred of them all. These were erected in the form of the Ophite hierogram, the serpent passing through the circle. This hierogram is the symbol of the serpent, a circle with a snake passing through it, like a needle and thread. He continues, they were composed like the circular temples of a number of betulia or amber stones, so arranged as to describe the mystic circle through which the still more mystic serpent trailed his majestic form. And this is the truth of the stone circles and physical hierograms, that they were, on this level, rebirthing circles, a being born again through the spirit, through the circle. To be born again in the sky, we needed to manifest the sky on earth. I can even make a remarkable deduction from the strange word Betulia mentioned by Dean. These are betel stones, or serpent's eggs. In Wales, the serpents were said to emerge and congregate on Midsummer's Eve to blow into the serpent stone eggs, which is reminiscent of the Roman historian Pliny's tale of this activity among the Gauls. These serpent stones were said to be coloured pebbles, which gave second sight and healing. Midsummer's Eve was the night when the serpents would roll themselves into hissing balls and create the Glain egg. This egg was also known as the Snake Stone or Druid's egg. In Welsh myth, even Merlin himself went in search of them. The egg, cosmic egg, or cosmogenic egg, is universally seen with the serpent. From the serpent mound of Ohio to Mithra, the egg is associated with serpent worship. Why? According to most scholars, it is the emblem of the mundane elements coming from the creating God. Therefore, it is a symbol of the elements of the universe. But surely there is another reason, a reason that would relate to early man as well. What is an egg? Simply, an entry portal into this world, a device to give life. And what animal is seen in relationship to this unique device and portal? It is the snake, a symbol of the life force that creates the device which gives life. The Egyptian creator deity, Kenef, was represented as a serpent with an egg thrust in from his mouth, just like the American Ohio Serpent Mound and other such places. From this egg proceeded the deity Ptah, the creative power and father god, who is the same as the Indian Brahma. These Brahma have been related by scholars to the Jewish Essene community, the Druids, and also to Mithra. Mithra was encircled by serpents and can be equated in many ways to Jesus, being a solar divinity and reborn on the 25th of December, just like the sun. There is little wonder that a Persian god such as Mithra and a Judaic semi-deity such as Jesus be linked when one understands that the folds of the ancient serpent cult were so all-encompassing that they encircled the globe like a leviathan. We can even see elements of this when Jesus is equated to the brazen serpent of Moses, when we are told to be wise as serpents, and that he even shed his shroud or skin once crucified upon the cross. Incidentally, snakes are still to this day nailed to trees in certain parts of Africa as a sacrifice for our sins, and the Druids even crucified the snake on the oak tree. And so, we have circular monuments and serpent mounds associated with the egg, which from all the evidence here simply gives us the conclusion that these were places of rebirth. One would push through the symbolic circle or out of the egg and slough off the old skin. But there is more evidence yet to be unearthed, and which reveals this sloughing of the skin to be linked to these ancient sites. We now need to turn to Greece. The classical Greeks frequently depicted a serpent squeezing between two upright stones, which they called petrae, or stone ambrosia. Ambrosia, of course, is the nectar and elixir of the gods. According to the 19th century archaeologist Bryant, Stonehenge was seen as amber stones, with nearby Amesbury previously being Ambrosbury as proof. In this way, the healing abilities of the megalithic stones is attributed to the serpent. In fact, we do still find traces of this in many stories about dragons who protect, serve, and heal those people of the stones. From each circle, In the Greek legend of Cadmus, we find that he was turned into a serpent or followed the serpent cult, and stone temples were erected in his honour. Pausanias helps us along and points out that in the road between Thebes and Gilsus, you may see a place encircled by select stones, which the Thebans call the serpent's head. So ancient tales may in fact be clues to the real identities of the serpents and dragons of fable, and these real identities may in fact be real and literal places and monuments. Places where, perhaps, snakes were held in high esteem by the ancient Ophites or serpent worshippers of the world. There are many more texts mentioning dragons and serpents, such as the one that Taxiles showed to Alexander the Great and which was sacred to Dionysus. It was said to be of enormous size, walled around and resided in a low, deep place. It is my conjecture that such places, like Stonehenge, were portals or gateways to the land of the serpents, places of mystery and rebirth, where offerings and sacrifices must be made to the serpent benefactor. Indeed, there is plenty of evidence now to show that such places were also great resonance boosters. That is, they amplified sound in peculiar ways, thus creating the booming sound of the dragon. The resonance creates spiral and serpent wave-like shapes from the dust and smoke, as the sound wave carries the particles along its serpentine path. The serpent could truly have been seen to rise and heard to roar. Just a little bit of change, you know. However, most people are not aware that similar mounds and monuments also appear elsewhere and often associated with a serpent or dragon in similar ways. The dragon, of course, is just another element of the serpent. It's a vicious circle in there. In 1871, at a meeting of the British Association in Edinburgh, a certain Mr. Feen gave an account of his discovery in Argyllshire of a similar mound. Several hundred feet long, 15 feet high and 30 feet broad. The tail tapered away, while a circular cairn, which he presumed to be the solar disk above the head of the Egyptian Uraeus, surmounted the head. Indeed, this is not a one-off. In the Zendavesta of the Zoroastrians, one of the heroes takes a rest on what he thinks is a bank, only to find out that it is a green snake. Obsession. Iphicrates related that in Mauritania, there were dragons of such extent that grass grew upon their backs, thus showing the highly likely chance that tales of massive dragons in far-off lands could easily be serpent mounds. Posidonius also tells of one in Syria, which was so large that horse riders on either side could not see each other. Each scale was as big as a shield, and that a man might ride into its very mouth. And what were these temples used for? In ancient Egyptian papyri, and in the Mesoamerican Codex Borgia, there are instances of tales of the king entering the serpent and going through it in order to be resurrected. Interesting to serpent mounds, however, is the description of a subterranean passage, which is said to terminate at the root of heaven. This was called a snake's hole, and Votan was only allowed in because he was the son of a snake. Surely, this can only mean that Votan was an initiate into the serpent cult, and that there was a ritualized serpent mound or pyramid which led to the snake heaven, or in India, Patala. The Finnian heroes of ancient Ireland are recorded orally in song, and one of them, Fionn, was their dragon slayer. One of the legends tells us, "It resembles a great mound, its jaws were yawning wide. There might lie concealed, though great its fury. 100 champions in its eye pits, taller in height than 8 men, was its tail, which was erect above its back. Thicker was the most slender part of its tail than the forest oak, which was sunk by the flood." Fionn asked where this great monster had come from, and was told, "From Greece to demand battle from the Finnians." It seems that the serpent worshippers had come to Ireland, believed to be from Greece, and had fought the ancient inhabitants, leaving behind such terror of them that they became symbolised as this great dragon mound. Fionn, it is said, opened the side of the dragon and released the men, going on to kill it. Why does the serpent appear so widespread in ancient tradition and mythology? The truth can be found within the mind. Now we can see in this also the dark side of the serpent, because many of the methods used by ancient man to access his own internal world has been the use of drugs, and even when the method is natural and involves meditation or prayer, the body's own hormone drug cabinet opens up and wanders freely. This access into the internal world, if uncontrolled, can cause serious mental problems. And even today, the so-called Kundalini experience, linked to the road to enlightenment, can and has caused psychosis. But more than that, those with psychosis have often had near Kundalini experiences. There are always two sides, and so we have to walk a pathway between these worlds of order and chaos. This pathway is multi-leveled. It is the hypnagogic, the point between waking and sleeping, and thereby enables us to be aware of the unconscious world. Within this realm, man sees what Carl Jung termed archetypes, things that we all see. Jeremy Narby and others have shown that one of these archetypes is the pattern of DNA, or indeed even the waveform. And as ancient man had no knowledge of DNA or waveforms, then he simply made a face out of the cloud and attributed the internal world to the snake. This is why the Naga of India, the serpents, live beneath the waters. This is why Christ could walk on water. Water itself was seen as the pathway to the other world and was symbolic of the hypnagogic state, the state between waking and sleeping, and our access into our very own quantum unconscious world. When we die, we look like we sleep. When we sleep, we look like we have died. And so our ancestors thought the two things were the same. To see what was within the sleeping state was to see what was there after death. And what was always there was the snake. In our book, The Serpent Grail, we go to extensive lengths to reveal for the first time that the Grail was in fact, on one level, a mixing bowl for the elixir of life, derived from one of the world's most mysterious animals, the snake. We show through modern science and ancient history that the venom and blood of the snake was mixed within a ritual bowl, which became known as the Grail. Through etymology, we reiterate that the Holy Grail was not in fact the bloodline of Christ, but actually meant mixing bowl. You see, the mistake of the authors who professed the bloodline theory was that they took just one error by a cleric in the 15th century where the word Sangreal was split incorrectly into Sangreal, and to use this as the whole baseline for their theory that the Grail was therefore the royal bloodline of Jesus Christ himself. The true etymology of Sangreal seems to revert back to kapa, or a bowl in which certain things were mixed. In this regard, something extremely important. Walter Skeat was one of the greatest investigators of the roots of the English language. In his English Etymology, he points out that the word was very early falsified by an intentional change from Sangreal to Sangreal. He claims that the word was a corruption of the Low Latin cretella, or a small bowl, which actually and originally meant a bowl in which things were mixed, from the Greek kapa, I mix. With this etymology and the discovery of the serpent venom science in mind, my research led me through time, working backwards from modern Europe and through into medieval France and Germany, into the English Middle Ages, and beyond even that, into Roman and Celtic Britain. I travelled across the ancient world, Greece, Cyprus, Malta, France, Portugal, South and North America, Africa, and even Egypt. What I uncovered was simply amazing. I found that on every continent, in every country, and in every faith, the serpent dwelt like a hidden clue to some fantastic treasure. With every specific and rigorous test I placed upon my own research, I simply kept coming up with the same remarkable conclusion. The snake was worshipped and revered across the globe in ancient times, and in every instance, the practices and rituals of worship were the same. But more than that, they were all based upon the same core truths. In fact, what I uncovered had implications far-reaching and often frightening. However, on the other hand, myself and Gary Osborne also uncovered an incredible ancient system of psychology that resounds with perfect common sense and yet is being missed by almost everybody. So to recap, we found across the world an ancient serpent brotherhood, united in tradition, language, myth, and creed. We found hidden secrets locked away in arcane language, and we found the amazing curative power of the snake's venom and blood was known by prehistoric man, and that it was known to our medieval friends as the elixir of life. We also discovered that this mixture was prepared within a sacred bowl or cap, which became the Holy Grail we know today. Our research has revealed that modern science was in fact coming to the same conclusion itself, that snake venom contained the very elements required for better health and life extension. This small packet of protein contains such high concentrations of beneficial elements that it is currently being researched across the world in scientific laboratories for all manner of life-threatening diseases. What we also discovered were the numerous historical mentions in Materia Medicus and alchemical texts of the use of this unique poison for healing. For Through a mixing of the venom and the blood, and even alcohol, the ancients from across the world developed ways of ingesting this historical vitamin pill. However, many will now be asking, how is it that a chalice said to have held the blood of Christ can now be a mixing bowl for snake venom? Christ was in fact seen and created to be the Serpent King, the deity of wisdom and immortality. This was seen more starkly in the beliefs of the early Christian Gnostics known as Ophites or serpent worshippers. These early Christians adored the serpent for its wise attributes and drank from the ritual cup of the Agatha demon or good serpent. This was an early Eucharist ritual.